opportunities as we look at the story of Ruth. We're just looking at one little piece today, a promise that Ruth made to her mother-in-law, Naomi. I want to give you a little bit of the story that brings them to that place and in that time where she shares that, those words of promise, of a vow that she makes to her mother-in-law. It all began really when the economy plummeted in Bethlehem. It was a place known as the House of Bread. You would think the place with House of Bread would be plenty. But the economy tanked. Very much what we had experienced here in our country, and we're just slowly starting to get a little bit better than we were a few years ago. Elimelech was concerned for his family because, like any good parent, he wanted to provide for his children. Wanted to provide for his wife, and yet as the economy was declining in Bethlehem, the best thing he could do was to move somewhere else. So he decides to pack up his wife, his two sons by the name of Mahlon and Chilion. They decide to move to a place called Moab. And Moab was a pretty sketchy type of place in that day and age because the Israelites and the Moabites, they didn't play fair with one another. And a lot of it had to do with the history that had accumulated for Moab, because back in the olden days, it's recorded in the book of Genesis, the first book of the Bible, a guy named Lot had an incestuous relationship with his daughter, the child's womb. And over history, that started a clan and a tribe, and they were called the Moabites, a dirty, untrustful type of people. And so these Israelites from Bethlehem, Elimelech's family, Elimelech's, decided to move to Moab because, in this case, even though they were people that were tarnished, tainted, and dirty, the economy was good. So Elimelech, whose name just happens to be God is strong, God is my Lord, or God will provide, takes his family because he believes in Moab, at least God will provide for his family there. He packs up his wife, Naomi, whose name means pleasant. He then packs up his two sons, again, I mentioned their names, Mahlon and Chilion, whose names, incidentally, mean sickly and feeble. Who would name their kids sickly and feeble? And the story, as it continues, they move to Moab, they're establishing a household. The boys find some Moabite girls that they're attracted to. And even though it was against the Israelite tradition to have an intermarriage, an intercultural marriage, a fear of marrying someone outside of their race, their culture, their tradition, because those bad Moabite girls might distract you and make you start worshiping their gods and not the God of Yahweh. What the greatest heresy would be if those two cultures got married. What else are those two brothers to do? They fall in love with two girls, and they marry. They have names. One is Orpah, and the other is the heroine from story Ruth. Life goes on for a short period of time. Elimelech gets sick. He dies. And shortly thereafter that, the boys die. Maybe it's because of their names, but I think they were kind of cursed from the beginning. They die too and really leave their mother, Naomi, and then the wives, Orpah and Ruth. They're left basically kind of stranded there in Moab with really nothing to do. The culture had set up really two conditions of its day. If you were a woman back in the day, at least in the day of Ruth and Naomi, the only way you could really be taken care of is one, if you had a husband. Your husband would take care of you, provide for you. It would be the idea and the rule of the household. Relatives of that brother, that husband, to take care of him. Another way would be if you were married to a man. In this case, the women got married, and they were taken care of. But the husbands died. Three women without their husbands, without their father, left in this country to fend for themselves. They're in a predatory culture because in those days, I'm sorry, but women were seen as less than less. back to Bethlehem, and two, you go back to their families. And somehow a bond had happened within the family system there. They weep over each other. They can't believe that they're going to separate in that respect. Orpah says, you know what? I think you're right, Mom. I'm going to go back and move in with my family. At least I know I'll be taken care of. And Ruth does something as she turns the tables. She says, I can't. I have to stay with you. She even goes on to really express a vow of promise to her, a vow that in Scripture is something that is usually shared between two people in a spousal relationship. She says, Mom, at that point she just looked at her and said, no. You know what? Where you go, I'm going to go. Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. Where you live, I will live. Where you die, I will die there. So help me God. She makes a vow. She makes this promise to her in such a way that these words have become so sincere even to this day. When two people stand before God in a congregation, they hold hands and look in the eyes of each other, and they too say, I will go where you go. I will live where you live. We're then doing this partnership together forever. These are sacred, holy words that were once shared between two women in such a way that is shared today, and I would hope they would continue to be. You see, it's interesting when we look at life as a journey. A life that takes us from one place to the next. Here you have Naomi who goes to Moab, and you have Ruth who goes back to Bethlehem. Each of them experience in a moment in their lives where they respond to a call to be faithful to one another. As I was reflecting upon this passage this week and upon Ruth and Naomi, I couldn't help but start thinking of that show. It was really in the reruns back then that I would watch when I would come home from school. It was that show called Laverne and Shirley. Remember those two wacky characters there? They shared a house together. They both worked in a brewery together. They enjoyed life together. They were committed as friends to one another. And as I watched that show, I couldn't help but think of Ruth and Naomi, the companionship that they had together. And in the midst of life, they too discovered who they are and who they were called to be. I invite you for just a moment here to follow and remember Laverne and Shirley.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, for me. So Hasselbeck Incorporated.
Going through the maze of life and eventually destination that equips us, strengthens us, and makes us who we are, and who God has called us to be in the first place. This is who Ruth and Naomi are, two individuals who claim a life of their own, how they follow in such a way that strengthens them as they look for ways, too, to survive in a society that will look down and frown upon them. Well, I said that this was somewhat of a teaching sermon this morning. So we might want to ask, well, what are some things that we can take home with us today? What are some steps that we might heed and learn from Ruth and Naomi, or from Laverne and Shirley, as they carry that theme of doing it our way, that we're just going to try things, we might fail, we might succeed, we're going to do it our way. And as we do it our way and God's way, there are some steps that we can take that we can learn as we respond to the call. The first step in doing it our way is to realize that God is in charge. Remember Elimelech's name? That God will be king. God is in charge, and as king of one who's in charge there, it means God will provide. God provides for Elimelech's family, and yet God provides for Ruth and Naomi, whether it be in Moab or in Bethlehem. Wherever we go in that journey, God will provide. We continue to do it our way and walk in God's way as we take that second step. And that second step is that reminder that we just need to venture out into new territory. We take that leap of faith, as they say, as we actually trust what's before us, because when we take that leap, when we go into new territory, we too grow and experience new things in our lives. Now, there's something pretty significant that happens in this friendship, this connection that Ruth and Naomi have. They're in-laws with each other, but somehow they're pretty tight. They're well connected. And as they weep on each other's shoulders, when Naomi says to Ruth, go back to your homeland, she says, no, I can't, because I'm going to go where you're going, I'm going to die where you die, your people, your God will be a part of me. And Naomi looks at Ruth and she says, thank you for dealing kindly with me. And God deal kindly with you. And that's that third step we take. We take that third step as we are kind with each other. We treat others just as we read in the Bible how we would like to be treated. It's that golden rule. And the fourth step that we take in doing it our way, which is doing it the way of God, is to always honor our promises, commitments, the covenant that we make. At one point there, her husband comes to her and says, I'd like to marry you. And she makes a covenant with him. And they are married. And even in death, she continues to honor that promise, not so much of the marriage, but the promise of family, the promise of caring for one another. So she follows through with that. I'm not sure what the situation or condition was, why she left Moab. We can talk about how the Bible says how a man and a woman will leave their families and start a new one together. Something significant. Something was revealed to both of those individuals. They realized that we can't go in life unless we do it together. So they go back walking in those steps as they've understood that God is one that will provide. God is one that will allow us to trust and to take up your faith. To always be kind with one another as we would want others to be kind to us. And ultimately to follow through with the promises we made. There's an Episcopal priest in New York, his name is Tom Herring, and he talks about following and how as Christians we follow Jesus. He says these words, he says, following Jesus isn't about arriving at some destination, and we get there and we finally say, ah, there it is. He says something a little bit different. He says, following Jesus isn't about attaining some measurable goal in life. What following is about, or what following Jesus is about, is just those days that haven't yet happened. It's about those days when we have yet to meet people that we will meet. It's about places that one hasn't gone. It's about forgiveness that one hasn't requested. I shared with you last week, it's been about 22 years that I left this church and went on to go to seminary. I come to a point in my life where, as a young adult, the church I grew up in wasn't feeding me. And yet I found as I went to places like Washington, D.C., Virginia, Russia, into Phoenix, I found myself clinging to those things that would feed my soul, but allow me to walk in those trusted steps of the journey. And then lo and behold, as things would have its twist and its turn, I come back here, no longer in that element of wanting to be fed, but to respond to the call to feed others. And that's really our message. And when we've gotten to a point where we think, I'm not getting fed anymore, then get up and start feeding others. Start stepping out into that trust and that obedience to God. Know that we can walk in those unknown places and spaces because someone's going to connect to us and cling to us. One that offers us with those very promises of hope. There's a literary author who's long gone from now, but his name is T.S. Eliot. His name pops up every once in a while. He said, only those who risk going too far can possibly find out how far one can go. So, what do we learn today? What do we take home with us? It's to trust. It's to allow ourselves to be who we are and God made us. Step out into those unknown territories. To be nice to each other. For those whom we have yet to meet that will lose our lives. And always it's to be a person of our word. Be a person of integrity. And follow through with our covenants. It's about doing it our way because in doing it our way we find God's way bringing to us. Walking with us and reminding us that we're not alone, that we're someplace where things can be alive. Let us pray. God, we give you thanks for that experience, for that understanding that you call us to trust, to be nice, to be faithful, to be a person of our word. Trust others who may come to us and ask to be fed spiritually or maybe even literally. Allow ourselves to be fed. But even those times, too, where we're called to extend that hand to feed others. We come before you this day. We ask that your Spirit would speak to our hearts, stir within our faith and in our journey an understanding of Scripture, where people have been once before, where we now intersect in this journey of faith.